Well, if you're visiting with us today, I want to welcome you as our guest. In your bulletin, you'll see a little QR code that you can scan and fill out your visitor information there, or you can grab a card in your pew back there. And we'd just like to know that you're visiting with us so that we can pray with you. And if you'd like me to call and contact you, I'd be happy to do that as well. Today's a special day for us here at First Baptist Church. We've been on the hunt for a new music minister over these last several months. And today we have Josh Powell and his family who are coming. I'm going to invite them just to come up so y'all can say hi to them real quickly, and then we'll get started with our service. This is Josh Powell, his daughter Anna, his wife Laura, his younger daughter Catherine, and on the end we have Kirby. Let's welcome them. Good to see you guys. So right now, Josh is a music minister at a church in Wichita Falls, and so he's down here in God's country for the weekend to hang out with us, and we're excited to have you guys. He's going to be leading our worship service today, and then after the service, we'll have a special business meeting for you to vote on him to become our new music minister. So thank you, guys. God bless you. We'll be praying for you.
Well, good morning to you. It is my pleasure to be here with you. Psalm chapter 122, in verse 1, it says, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. So this morning, we're going to sing with joy as we enter in the house of the Lord. There is joy in the house of the Lord. If you would stand with us, we're going to sing.
Of the Lord, my God is surely in this place. We won't be
Let's continue to singing Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound.
Why we stand here now forgiven. Unless the Lord builds a house, its builders labor over it in vain. Unless the Lord watches over a city, the watchmen stay alert in vain. In vain you get up early and stay up late, working hard enough to have enough food. Yes, he gives sleep to the ones he loves. May we pray. Dear Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for the time to worship you. Father, we know that you have to be in everything, Lord, in order for it to be blessed and successful. Father, we seek out your will. We ask for your Holy Spirit to guide us, Father. And we ask for you to be in everything that we do to build your kingdom. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to serve with our hands and feet. We pray your blessings, Lord, for this church, as we seek the truth, Father, and seek to be kingdom builders. Thank you, Father, for those who have gone before us, Lord, to serve and are now rejoicing in heaven with you. And Father, help us, Lord, who stay here and who work, to always seek your will. For it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
We're going to continue to worship through song this morning. And we just want to invite you to be comfortable, to be yourself in worship. So if you want to stand as we sing, that's great. And if you are unable to stand, if you want to be seated, that's great. That's just as great. But the idea is that we are lifting our heart's affection and our mind's attention to the Lord Jesus Christ as we worship him today. This next song is "Oh, How I Love Jesus," and we invite you to stand, to sit, to lift your voices as we sing.
There is a name I love to hear, I love to sing its word. It sounds as music in my ear, the sweetest name on earth. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me. It tells me of a Savior's love who died to set me free. It tells me of his precious blood, the sinner's perfect plea. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. tells me what my Father has in store for every day. And though I hear a darksome path, His sunshine all the way. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because He first loved me. It tells of one who's loving heart can feel my deepest woe. Who in each sorrow bears a part that none can bear below. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because He first loved me.
Jesus told a parable, the parable of the prodigal son. And at the end of that parable, after all seems to be lost and the young man decides to return home, he says, I'll go live as a servant in my father's house because even they get to eat. And the father is standing out looking down the road and he sees his son off in the distance and he begins to run to him. This next song is a wonderful embracing of that parable. God's word says that when we draw near to Him, He will draw near to us. That He wants to draw us into His arms. That He wants us to be His. And so this next song, Run to the Father, is about what we do when we are in need. I've carried a burden run too long on my own. I wasn't created to bear it alone. I hear your invitation to let it all go. I see it now, I'm laying it down. All I know is I need you. I run to the Father, fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend. So I run to the Father again and again. And again and again. Oh, 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 and again and again. You saw my condition, had a plan from the start. Your son for redemption, the price for my heart. I don't have a context of that kind of love. I don't understand, can't comprehend. All I know is I need you. Run to the Father. Fall into grace, done with the hiding, reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, soul needs a friend. So I run to the Father again and again and again and again. Oh. Running into your
Let us pray together. Father God, we run to you again and again
into your open arms. Father, you have given us so much every time we come to you. As we return to you a portion of that gift, Lord, we ask that you would bless this gift, that you would bless this gift for your kingdom work, Lord, that the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ would go forth from this place, that you would be honored and glorified in all that we do. We thank you for everything you've done for us, Lord, and we thank you for everything you are going to do in this place. And it's in Jesus' name we pray these things. Amen.
Had to finish that song or the lights were going to start dimming over at the hospital. That was awesome. Well, hey, it's good to see everybody here this morning. We started a little series through the book of Ezra and Nehemiah, some Old Testament books, and we're going to continue in that today. But before we do, you know, for parents nowadays, I suspect you can probably identify with just how overly complicated everything seems to be with regards to our children. Now, I remember a couple years ago, we signed up one of our kids to play in softball. And the whole point of it was just to learn the basics of softball. And you learn from the very get-go that it's so much more than that nowadays. You've got to have two sets of color coordinating socks, and they're going to let you know like 2 hours before the game which color socks. I can tell you, I'm sorry, but my child barely had the right ones on. We got it mixed up every time. And then you go to the first practice and the coach says, well, you've got to download this app onto your phone in order to communicate. Well, that works when you have one kid, but when you have four kids, it's like every organization uses a different app. So we have like all these different communication apps on our phone and they all just get you confused. And then you get to play and they say, well, you know, it's all well and good, but you know, you're going to need to go get a matching bag to match all the other players' bags, and then you're going to, you know, we'd really prefer if you bought these matching shoes. Okay, and then it just goes on and on. Then towards the end of the season, now at the end of the season, we're going to start a travel team. A travel team? Well, my kid's only five, but okay. Tell me about the travel team. Well, the travel team, you know, you're going to have to buy new uniforms and get new matching bags, and we'll be traveling 3 weeks out of the weekend. And so we knew we were going to be out of that real quick. But, you know, it just seems like life right now in so many different aspects just seems overly complicated. Man, I just wanted my kid to learn how to bat the ball and throw and have some fun. And now all of a sudden there's all these extra layers and complications. And that's just how life goes. Sometimes you just wish, can we just get back to the basics? Can we just, like, have the Bad News Bears again, you know, where we just have the kids out there. The coach is kind of like, hey, kids, throw the ball around, have a good time, whatever. Today we're going to talk about getting back to the basics. I know as a Christian there are times in life where it just feels like being a Christian or even going to church or the work of the church seems to be overly complicated. And as I was reading through Ezra over the last couple weeks, we're reminded that these people had been led out of their land for 70 years because they had been disobedient to God. And so God allowed invaders to come in and take over Jerusalem. And so the Israelites had been gone for 70 years. And now God, through a decree of King Cyrus, working behind the scenes, as we talked about last week, has invited his people to come back, and they have a specific task, and that specific task is to rebuild the temple. And so in chapter 1, we talked about last week the sovereignty of God and how God is at work behind the scenes. He's orchestrating things in history before they even happen. That ought to be encouragement to us Christians, that God has worked in history before it happens. God can work through any government. Even the worst government on earth, God can work through those governments. All the kings and queens and hierarchy of people in this world ultimately are only in their position of authority because God has allowed it. And then we talked about God, how he can encourage his people to go and to give towards his purposes. And so that was chapter 1. And then we go into chapter 2. Now, if you're a preacher and you can read through chapter 2 of Ezra and come up with a good sermon out of chapter 2, I would love for you to come get with me after the service. Chapter 2 is a list of all the people that were going to be coming to Jerusalem. That's my sermon. So let's go on to chapter 3. So in chapter 3, in verses 1 through 6, I'd like to talk today about five basics for every believer. We've got the people, they're coming back now, the first group of them. We talked about last week how there's going to be three groups of people who are going to be returning. This first group was led by a guy by the name of Zerubbabel, and he brings them back, and now we're going to see five basics for every believer. Let's read these first six verses. Now, when the seventh month came and the sons of Israel were in the cities, the people gathered together as one man in Jerusalem. Then Jeshua, the son of Jozadak, and his brothers, the priest, and Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, and his brothers arose and built the altar of the God of Israel to offer burnt offerings on it, as it is written in the law of Moses, the man of God. So they set up an altar on its foundation, for they were terrified because of the peoples of these lands, and they offered burnt offerings on it to the Lord, burnt offerings morning and evening. They celebrated the Feast of Booths, as it is written, and offered the fixed number of burnt offerings daily, according to the ordinance, as each day required. And afterward, there was a continual burnt offering, also for the new moons, and for all the fixed festivals of the Lord that were consecrated, and from everyone who offered a freewill offering to the Lord. From the first day of the seventh month, they began to offer burnt offerings to the Lord, but the foundation of the temple of the Lord had not been laid. Again, today we're going to see five basics for every believer. These people had been out of Jerusalem for 70 years. They came back. Can you imagine the monumental task that lay before them? We've got to rebuild this temple, this city that lies in ruins. There's so much to do. It could be so overly complicating. And in these first six verses, we see five basics that I think apply not only back then, but they apply to the church and more specifically each and every Christian today. If we look at verse 1, it says, in the seventh month, the sons of Israel were in the cities. The people gathered together as one man to Jerusalem. Now, I think that's interesting at the end of verse 1. It says they were gathered together, and your version may say as one people. Mine says as one man, that's an interesting little detail that the author has put in here. They're all gathered together, but they're gathered together as one man. When you think about churches in our world today, do you see churches operating together as one person? Or do you see churches operating together as a bunch of individuals? Unfortunately, a lot of times when I look around, I see churches operating as one man, a star preacher with a big name who's got a website and a book deal and goes around and does evening events with people all around the world. But more and more in our Western world, it's more about that individual and the star than it is about the church all together acting as one in unity. And these people, as they were coming back, the author makes the point to say that they were all acting together. They were acting in unity. Psalm chapter 133, verse 1 says, "Behold, how good and how pleasant it is for brothers to live together in unity." The Bible describes the church as a body with many members or many parts in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. And we are all the different parts of the body, and we work together in unison to accomplish Christ's purposes for us on this earth. And then in Jesus, in John chapter 17, in his high priestly prayer, he says this in verse 23, and I think it really sums up the importance of unity very well. It says, "I in them and you in me, that they may be perfected in unity." And then he gives the reason why. "So that the world may know that you sent me and you love them just as you loved me." The Bible says that we should all love one another. That's a sign for the world to see. But the Bible also tells us that we should do church and live as Christians in unity. That should be what the outside world sees when they see our churches and when they see our walk in the Lord. They should see us living in unity. And so this is our first back to the basics. Number one, strive to live in unity with other believers. If we're going to accomplish anything, I mean, they had a big task to accomplish. They had to rebuild the temple of God. And if they were ever going to get down to rebuilding the temple of God, they were only going to do it if they were unified. And I believe the same is true for us right here at First Baptist Church on the corner of Oaks and Harris Street, San Angelo, Texas. We've been here for 120 some odd years. And in many ways, we're still just getting started, hopefully, with what God has for us to do right here in San Angelo and across the world. And if we're ever going to get down to it and really accomplish what God has for our church, it has to be from a place of unity. We've got to be together. We got to be on the same ship together. I think about the few times in my life when I've gone to see the symphony. Now, before the symphony starts, you hear all sorts of god-awful sounds coming from up where the orchestra plays. You hear the and then it just, none of it goes together. But then all of a sudden, the conductor gets up and holds his baton up and strikes it on the podium a couple times. And all these instruments that were making all these strange, funny sounds, some of them, honestly, on their own, are ugly. I mean, there are some instruments that are in the symphony that I just would never, I mean, if you're a bassoon player, I love the bassoon, but I'm just probably not ever going to go to a bassoon solo concert. I'm just probably never going to make that one. But you know what? When you throw it in there with the harmony and the other instruments in the orchestra, and they all play in unity once they're following the conductor and following the music on the sheet, something beautiful and amazing happens. You know, when you have a church where people are all just trying to do their own thing, it just makes a big old mess. But when we're all submitted to Christ and he's the conductor and we're willing to follow his lead and be on plan for whatever his plan is, beautiful things can happen. That's true in your life too. So are you striving to live in unity amongst other Christians, especially those right here in our local church, or are you just doing your own thing? God has called us to live in unity. If we're going to get back to the basics, we need to live in unity. Now let's move on to verse 2. "Then Jeshua, the son of Jozadak, and his brothers the priest, and Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, and his brothers arose and built an altar to God, built the altar of the God of Israel to offer burnt offerings on it, as it is written in the law of Moses, the man of God." Now, this principle here really applies to the rest of the passage. It's interesting when you're reading through this passage how specifically that they were doing all of these different activities, all these religious activities. They're setting up the altar, and the author makes a very important point to note how detailed they are in doing what? Following the word of God. Not only are they living in unity, but it says right here in verse 2, they're doing all these things as it is written in the law of Moses. Now, what's the law of Moses? It's the first five books of the Bible. Some people call it the law or the Pentateuch or the Torah. At that time in the history of the Jewish people, that's what they had to refer to, the first five books in the Bible. Well, now we're a little bit further in that history, and we've got 66 books to refer to. Are we living our lives according to as it is written, what the Word of God says? Or are we just doing whatever we want? As complicated as life can become, it's important to always remember that we need to be able to come back to the Scripture. And this brings us to our second back to the basics. Follow the Bible as authoritative. Life had been crazy for these people for the last 70 years. They finally get to come back to Jerusalem, and what are they going to do? Just follow the Word of God. We live in an absolutely crazy time. I mean, we've got war breaking out all over the world. We've always got some threat of some other enemy. It seems like the culture is just closing down on us with all of these things that seem to be so in opposition to what God would have us to live for. What are we going to do? Just follow the Word. Live by the Bible. I don't know what your truth is going to be, but my truth needs to be the Word of God. This is going to be the authority in my life. This is going to be the standard. This is going to be the fixture, the one thing that I'm going to hold fast to no matter what. It reminded me of a movie that Amy and I watched not too long ago. It's called All Is Lost. Now, I don't know if you've seen this movie. It's quite an interesting movie. You probably might not like it, but I like these kind of movies. He only says one word in the whole movie, and it's a curse word. But other than that, it's a movie. Robert Redford plays a sailor, and he's out on his boat, and the boat starts to sink. And the whole movie is him trying to figure out what to do out in the middle of the ocean as his little boat is sinking. And he finally comes to the point where he realizes the sailboat is going to sink, and he's going to have to get in the blow-up life rest. And so he's kind of swimming around inside of this sailboat. And as he's swimming around inside of the sailboat, he's kind of looking at all the supplies and deciding what is it that he's going to need. And he makes a point to find this box. And when he gets over into the life raft, he opens up that box. You know what's in that box? It's a device called a sextant. And it's one of these real funny looking devices that you can look at the stars with. And they use it to navigate the stars. And then he also had a map. Ultimately, that was what was going to lead him to his rescue. Because without that, he was never going to have any sense of his bearings or his whereabouts or what direction that he was going to go in. Christian, if we don't have the Bible as authority in our life, then we are just drifting around in the ocean, and we're never going to have any direction, and we're never going to get to where God wants us to go. And so the only thing you need, the only sextant you need to get pointed in the right direction and to find your bearings, it's not a yoga mat, it's not some inspirational speaker, it's just the Word of God. Everything you need is right here in the Word of God. We look for truth and direction in all sorts of places, but the Bible is all we need. Let's move on to verse 3. In verse 3, the author says, "So they set up an altar on its foundation, for they were terrified because of the peoples of the lands, and they offered burnt offerings on it to the Lord." Burnt offerings, morning and evening. Now, this verse is setting up the stage to what's going to happen further on in the book. We'll have some more discussion about that later at a time. But what we see happening right here is, turns out, everything's not all rosy back in Jerusalem. They got back to Jerusalem, and there's some people there that were had them shaking in their boots. So what are we going to do? We got back to where God has called us to be. What are we going to do? It's scary here. These people aren't what we were hoping for. They're they going to attack us? Are they going to hurt us? What are they going to do? Well, what did they do? They just continued to do what God had called them to do. They set up. They started doing their offerings. In fact, they were doing their offerings because they were scared. They knew that God was the source of all the power and authority that they needed in their life, and that God could do whatever he wanted with these people. And so instead of acting out on their own or running away, they decided to just trust in the Lord. In other words, they had courage. They didn't run away from the things that terrified them. They lived with courage and they pursued God's plan. One commentator that I was reading this week said it this way: courage is not the lack of fear, it is the will to act in spite of fear. Just because you're afraid doesn't mean that you have faith or that you're not following God. Fear ought to drive you to be courageous and continue to follow God and take action, even in spite of that fear. This brings us to number three, for back to the basics. Live courageously for God. There have been so many fine examples, not only in our church, but throughout Christian history, of people who've been willing to live courageously for God, to act in spite of fear. One such missionary was a gentleman that lived in the 1800s, and his name was John Patton. John Patton had a very clear calling in his life to go and be a missionary to some cannibals who lived on some islands in the southern South Pacific. Now, can you imagine what that would have been like in the 1800s? You would have had little to no information about them. Getting there would have been absolutely monumental. And once you're there, you're there. It ain't like you can get a plane ticket or a ship to get out. And so this guy is basically, in the eyes of many, just signing up for a death sentence. You're going to go tell people about Jesus who eat people? That's just not going to work. There's no way that that's going to work. But he went anyways. When he first got accepted to the work among the cannibals of this place called New Hebrides, there were people who tried to persuade him not to go. One old gentleman warned John, "The cannibals, you will be eaten by the cannibals." And he responded by saying this. John replied that he may as well give his life for Christ, since in the end his body will rot in the ground. To me, that's living courageously for Christ. If God has called me to do something, I'm going to go and do it and live courageously no matter what the cost. John Patton was a man who lived courageously. Are you living courageously? Let's move on to verse 4. They celebrated the Feast of Booths, as it is written, and offered the fixed number of burnt offerings daily, according to the ordinance, as each day required. And afterward, there was a continual burnt offering, also for the new moons and for all the fixed festivals of the Lord that were consecrated, and from everyone who offered a freewill offering to the Lord. Now, the Feast of Booths, there were three big pilgrimage religious events on the Jewish calendar, and the Feast of Booths was the third one. It happened in the fall. And so all the Jewish men were called to go to Jerusalem three times a year, and so this would have been the third time. They go up to Jerusalem to celebrate the Feast of Booths. It's a week-long celebration that had a lot of interesting caveats to it, but one that's a very interesting caveat in my estimation is you had to live in a tent all week, or a booth. And so they would go all the way up to Jerusalem, and then they would go and live in a tent all week. And this celebration was a remembrance of what God had done for the Israelites while they were in the wilderness. And it was a reminder to them that the comforts of life are ultimately not where you get your security from. You can be sleeping in a tent, and God can be taking absolute care of you, because God is the one who's powerful. God is the one who's in control. God is our source of peace and comfort, not the temporary trappings of this world. And so each year they would come and celebrate this. And in particularly, this was important to these people who'd been out in the wilderness, if you will, for the last 70 years. And they had just come back, and then they immediately start celebrating this festival to remind them of what God did for them and to not get too comfortable now that they're back in Jerusalem. This brings us to our back to the basics number 4. Remember that this life is temporary. They celebrated the Feast of Booths. It reminded them, this life's temporary. You don't need to get all caught up in the trappings of this world because it's God who's going to take care of you. That's why we're going to stay in a tent all week. So maybe you just need to pinch up a tent in your backyard this week and sleep out there for the week and just remember that God's the one in control and we don't need to have all the comforts of this world. With all my moving, I'm only one or two moves away from being in a tent, I promise. You know, there's something about sleeping in a tent, though. There really truly is. I remember a few years ago, we took a big trip up to Canada. And it was a neat experience because we went up in this national park in Canada called Quetico. And you can't have anything really modern. You have to canoe to your destinations with the paddle, and once you're in there, you're in there. And if you die, you just die. You know, like back in the old days, when people just died, they just died, you know? So it's like you're back in the wilderness, and you're sleeping in your tent, and if you die, well, then they'll find you in a month or two, I guess. And so I remember when we first got there, it was all the men on our side of the family, my brother-in-law, and our kids. In the first couple days, we were just like, it really wasn't very fun at all. It was miserable, in fact, because it was like, why is everything taking so long? It's like, man, it took like 3 hours to set up the tent, and then it took like another 2 hours to just cook this measly little food, and then it takes another hour to like, you got to get down on, you know, you got to like squat down and wash your dishes. It's just the whole camping experience, right? And then after about 3 or 4 days, though, after you kind of like get used to it, you just start to experience this grand sense of freedom. Like, oh, this is great. It's great that it's taking 2 hours to wash the dishes. It's great that it's doing all this. And then you realize, you know what? There are people who live their whole life like this, and they are just as important to God as me, who thinks I'm so important, living in my house and doing all these things that I consider to be important. Living in a tent does something to us. It reminds us that this life is temporary. And so the Israelites had gone, and they were celebrating the Feast of Booths, and God was reminding them that this life is temporary. And we need to remember that, not get so trapped up in the stuff that this world has to offer. Then we come to verse 6. And in verse 6, the author says, from the first day of the seventh month, they began to offer burnt offerings to the Lord, but the foundation of the temple of the Lord had not been laid. Now, as we go on through the book of Ezra, we'll see that they have trouble getting the work started for various reasons. But for today, and for the sake of today's sermon and where they were at that point, the reminder that we get from God's work today is there's always more work to be done. They came and, yeah, it's great you got some of these things kind of started back up, but there is still work to be done. The temple has not been built. And this brings us to our fifth, back to the basics. Keep working for the Lord. There is no retirement in serving the Lord. You don't get to retire. You may have accomplished some wonderful things in your life, but God still has something for you. Because the Bible says we are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand so that we would walk in them. Are you walking in the works that God has prepared for you today? Even if you can't walk, even if you have a hard time getting around, God still has something prepared for you to do on this earth as long as you're taking breath. And so don't give up. Don't give in. Don't quit. Keep working for the Lord. Five basics of getting back to the basics of being a Christian. Just living in unity, trusting in the Lord, and remembering that the work is not done yet. The number one back to the basic is this, though. You can do whatever you want in this life to try to earn God's favor, and it's never going to do you any good. You can go to church every week. You can read every religious book all around. But the most important back to the basic is to remember what God has already done for you on the cross when Jesus died for your sins. What you need to do is put your faith in Jesus as your Lord and Savior. We don't do these things back to the basics to earn God's favor. We do them because we already have Jesus as our Lord and Savior, and we love him and we want to live according to his will. If you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior today, I want to invite you during our time of invitation to come forward and give your life to him. I'm going to invite Josh to come up now, and we're going to close with a word of prayer. And as we do, I'm just going to ask that you would consider what the Holy Spirit is doing in your life today. And if he's calling you to respond, would you come forward and respond? Let's pray. Father God, we just come before you today, and we confess that life so oftentimes does seem to get overcomplicated, overwhelming. Help us just to come back to the basics today. Help us to live our lives simply. Help us to live our lives according to your will. Help us to set your word as the standard in our lives. And Father, I just pray for any man, woman, or child who's here today that may just sense that you're working in their heart and stirring them to action. I pray that they would have the courage to just step forward and make a decision for you today. We give you all the praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
Would you stand with us, please?
To have a very quick special call business meeting to consider a motion from the personnel committee and vote on Josh as our next music minister. If you're here visiting today or you just can't stay, I'm going to just close us with a word of prayer and give everybody a minute or two to either sit down or take off if you need to, and then we'll convene our very brief meeting, hopefully. Let's have a word of prayer. God, I thank you for this day, Lord, and I just pray that, Father, you would go ahead of us before this meeting today. And that, God, you would just guide our church into, God, what it is that you would have for us. Father, our desire is just to submit to your will for this church, not our own will, but your will. And so, God, may thy will be done in our meeting today and going forward. We just give you all the praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
I am glad to announce that we have a new minister of music for First Baptist San Angelo.
Call Josh as our new music minister. The plan right now is he will be here for the very first Sunday in July. So it's going to take them just a few weeks. Now, I know that sounds like that's a long time away, but it's really not. It's not at all. So they're going to be moving. The Lord has blessed them with hopefully some favor. They think they may have found a place and all those kind of good things. So yes, a temporary tent. So I'm gonna pray for them, and then I'm going to invite you guys just to come by and greet them and extend a right hand of Christian Fellowship to this new minister. All right, let's have a word of prayer. God, I thank you for the Powell family. And I thank you, Lord, for adding them to our number. I pray that, God, you would just give Josh wisdom to lead our church, to just draw near to you. I thank you for the gifts and talents that you've given him. But, Lord, ultimately, what I pray and ask for, God, is that you would just give him the courage to be fully submitted to where it is that you're leading him to steer our church and the worship ministry into the future. God, we're hopeful and pray for great things in the future. We pray that the transition would be a good one. We pray for the kids, Father, that they would make lots of new friends and it would be a good transition for them. We pray for Josh's wife too, Lord, as she seeks employment. God, that you would give her favor with that as well. We give you all the praise, and Lord, we just thank you for our new music minister. In Jesus' name, amen.